Blackstone Audio presents Parrots Prove Deadly, a Pru Marlowe pet noir by Clea Simon. This book is read by Tavia Gilbert. For John. Chapter 1. Polly didn't want a cracker. Polly didn't want much of anything anymore. Polly Larkin, a.k.a. Room 203, had been dead several hours when her aide came to wake her, early on the morning of September 3rd, and her days of haranguing the staff were done. Nobody was surprised much by Polly's demise, least of all the aide. That she'd toppled to the floor at some point in the night, knocking over her walker, was unfortunate, but not shocking. Polly had been sickly for as long as anyone could remember. Sickly and stubborn, refusing requests that she stay in bed until her aide or a night nurse could be summoned, and at 84, nobody expected her to last much longer. But even an anticipated death sets off repercussions in the world of the living, and while the assisted living staff was handling the arrangements, I had to deal with the parrot. Randolph Jones, that was the parrot's name, and whether that was the deceased's idea of a joke or a handle the old lady had inherited when she adopted the bird was not shared with me. What I did get was an urgent phone call from the daughter, begging me to call her back on a matter of utmost importance. "Please," the voice on the message gasped. "I need your help. It's life or death." I was making coffee when I heard the message, and I confess, it didn't make me pause. I didn't know at that point that the old lady had passed 3 days before, but I've been in this business long enough to know that life or death rarely is. I'm an animal behaviorist, or almost, not a cardiologist or brain surgeon, which means I work with people's pets rather than anything they really care about. Used to be I'd spend my time trying to understand why domesticated animals did what they did. If Spot's pooping on the floor, you know he's got a reason, same as you would. What the clients pay me for, though, isn't an explanation. It's behavior modification. They want the behavior changed, and my job is to change it. I've gotten used to that. Hey, it beats watching Spot taken to the pound, or worse, released by the roadside, miles out of town, as they still do in my semi-rural burg. I've developed a repertoire of training tricks, re-education, if you will, to help everyone adjust. My refusal to pick up the phone before 9 a.m. is an attempt to use the same techniques on the owners. It rarely works, but it's the principle as much as anything. Besides, I knew I'd be no good before I had my caffeine. In addition, while I was grinding the beans, Wallis had come into the room, and serving her breakfast trumps everything. And so while the coffee was brewing, I cracked open 2 eggs and scrambled them in butter. She kneaded the floor in anticipation, and so I didn't even wait for them to cool before scooping them onto a plate and placing them on the floor. Wallis may be a cat, a mature tabby who has shared the last 12 years of her life with me, but she has more sense than most humans. If I had to talk down some hysterical would-be client, I wanted her in the room, and in the mood to consult. Besides, I cared about her happiness. The caller? Well, we'd see about that. Jane? Jane Larkin, this is Pru Marlowe, returning your call. I'd taken my mug over to the big farmhouse table that serves as a general workspace. You said you had a problem? From the stuttering on the other end, I thought she'd forgotten me already. That was fine. I didn't need another client, especially not one who indulged in histrionics.
Oh, Miss Marlowe, thank you.
She had someone else in the room, I realized. I raised my eyebrows to Wallis, who started to bathe.
Things are just so crazy here.
I looked at the clock. 9:05, late enough for me to begin my morning rounds. I can call you back later.
No, please. Can you come over today? The vet at the county animal hospital said you were a miracle worker, and I need... Well, could you just come over?
I heard a deep sigh.
I've got a real problem with a very aggravated parrot.
I still hadn't heard how an angry bird translated to life or death, but I agreed to head over once I was done with my regular visits. She'd given me an address on the new side of Beauville, in the complex called Live Well. Even I knew that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.